When it comes to the presidency of Donald Trump, there are many of us who have been disappointed by the lack of a counter-revolution to oppose what is currently being called cancel culture, which is simply another name for the enforcement of social justice. Prior to the coming 2020 presidential election, questions on how things have gone wrong must be answered. Many have declared that Donald Trump has betrayed his voter base, but I don't find this story very compelling. For the betrayal story to be true, the basic hypothesis is that there would have to be something offered, either implicitly or explicitly, that Trump did not have access to before his presidency. Considering his known associations with the upper echelons of the elites, it is difficult to imagine what possible interest of Trump's could have been achieved through the means of presidential betrayal that could not have been achieved before. This hypothesis puts every action Trump has taken into the space of insincerity, and fails to explain actions like his recent executive orders against critical race theory. It is clear that Trump threatens the cathedral at least a little bit, and therefore, even if at best he merely shines a light on such things, it wouldn't make sense for him to do this unless he were not part of the cathedral. Without telepathic powers, we will never truly know Trump's motivations or what transpired to cripple the Trump administration. At best, we can test a hypothesis logically using theory. With the application of neo-reactionary theory, we can offer a hypothesis with more specific explanatory power. Mencius Moldbug has in the past related corporations to monarchies, particularly corporations that follow hereditary succession in ownership. The Trump Organization is, of course, one such company. The owner of a company, especially as a sole proprietor and CEO, can expect that his orders will be obeyed. A company, especially of significantly large size, may have internal power struggles and competition in the lower levels, but all sovereignty ultimately rests in the CEO. As a principal owner of the Trump Organization, Donald Trump could basically expect that his orders would be followed in good faith. The incentive structure of a company is such that it is usually within your individual interest to follow the chain of command and act in a manner that benefits the company. The President of the United States, as the chief executive, may be similar in name and intended function as the CEO of a corporation, but the President isn't nearly so powerful. Some companies have an accountability framework above the CEO, commonly a board of directors. Even in such a case, the CEO generally still enjoys broad freedom to execute his will within this accountability framework. The United States perhaps was intended to have an accountability framework via the separation of powers, but it has degenerated into a managerial framework. And the path to this was written in the U.S. Constitution itself. In Article 2, that which describes the powers of the executive, Section 2 reads, quote, "He shall have power, by and with the advice and consent of the Senate, to make treaties, provided 2/3 of the senators present concur, and he shall nominate, and by and with the advice and consent of the Senate, shall appoint ambassadors, other public ministers and councils, judges of the Supreme Court, and all other officers of the United States, whose appointments are not herein otherwise provided for, and which shall be established by law. But the Congress may by law vest the appointment of such inferior officers, as they think proper, in the President alone, in the courts of law, or in the heads of departments." End quote. This basically says that the President can employ people that report to him, but Congress gets veto power over appointments, if they so choose to establish in law this oversight power. And Congress has certainly used this lawmaking power liberally. This short paragraph from the original legal text is what provided the legal foundation for the managerial state, and is what may have stalled the Trump presidency from day one. As a side note, it is worth noting that advice and consent was originally limited to the Senate, which, as the upper house, was not at the time democratically elected, as the House was. And of course, besides the three formal branches of government, and even the parties, if we think back to the Iron Polygon, it is clear that there are many more centers of power in the United States. Extra-governmental entities such as financial institutions, academia, and the media have appended to these significantly, and these power centers are always in competition to draw more power into their own sphere of influence, and away from competitors like President Trump. Corporations are in a perpetual state of competition as well, but as distinct self-governing entities. Sovereignty is all or nothing, and the distributed nature and malleability of sovereignty in USG leads to an adversarial condition between the power centers of USG, where they compete in an arms race to redistribute more sovereignty to themselves, necessarily subtracting from the others. This effect will slow down even an ideologically aligned regime. To some extent, the system is working as intended. On the other hand, and more on this later, it is able to spontaneously coordinate when it senses a threat to the relative stability enjoyed by the Iron Polygon. This is the situation in which Donald Trump found himself when he was elected President of the United States. Many people like the idea of having a business leader as a president, but consider the naive approach such a person might take to directing USG. Donald Trump may have viewed his election as a sort of hostile corporate takeover. Obama's management team was out, and Trump's was in. In a normal circumstance, it would mean that the company was formally and properly under the new management's control. In USG, this was not the case at all. Trump and his team would have found that formal control over the executive branch did not in practice give them significant power over the executive apparatus. They would have found it difficult or impossible to remove obstinate public servants, or even identify which ones needed removal. To someone like Trump, the failure to bring an organization to heel could be recognized as a leadership problem. Trump was not going to fire himself, so he may instead have chosen to replace parts of his administration with people more familiar with the USG apparatus. This hypothesis offers a possible explanation for Trump firing many of his loyal operators in the first year of his presidency, and replacing them with swamp creatures. But of course, no matter how much Trump corrupted his administration, he was never going to get USG to do his bidding. The incentive structure in USG is simply not set up in such a way as to incentivize obeying the formal power structure when the formal power structure threatens the cathedral. And let's face it, Donald Trump isn't exactly known for his skills as a CEO. He's famous because he is a celebrity billionaire who very successfully built a popular image, but this type of skill has little to do with bringing USG to heel. The question is, if Trump could not do it, was there anyone who could have done it? Your answer to this and other questions will lead to substantially different conclusions regarding what ought to or ought not be done in response to the cathedral. If you think that Trump could have actually fixed problems if he wanted to, but betrayed the platform he campaigned on, this leads to the conclusion that we simply need to elect someone who is capable and will not betray his promises. Let's say that Trump did indeed have every intention to right the problems he saw in the United States, and had the skill to fix them properly, were he able to do so. We know that, even if this is true, he was unable to match the power of the cathedral. Should we elect someone else instead? A better Trump? It is pointless to only think about what Trump should have done, especially in the general sense. It didn't happen, and the only thing to consider is what to do next. If the idea is that all that is needed is a better president, someone who could do what Trump couldn't, we have to ask, what is it that Trump should have done that he didn't do? The fact is, virtually everyone watching this video is not and never will be privy to such information. We can make broad statements regarding preferences, such as Trump should have appointed better justices, Trump should have ended illegal immigration, Trump should have built the wall, Trump should have drained the swamp. But this simply will not do for any serious attempt at political change. We could even get more specific regarding citing specific laws that Trump could have leveraged through executive orders against certain technology firms, but as we know, you cannot simply write off the cathedral with a simple presidential order. Before we talk about electing a better Trump or even re-electing him for similar reasons, we need to actually understand the problem space. This is where theory is so important. Good theory can give us the correct answers in the absence of empirical observation, perhaps even in spite of it. Neo-reactionary theory is essentially a modern repetition of elite theory, and it describes the problem space very well. In his first essay on The Clear Pill, Mencius Moldbug describes the civic and political cores of the two-story state. The two-story state, as opposed to the one-story state, is a state in which stagecraft is preferred over repression. Instead of a single story that everyone is forced to believe, there are two stories in active political conflict, and this conflict is made innocuous through containment. This is the left-right, liberal-conservative, or Democrat-Republican conflict. With the public distracted by this conflict, the civic core is protected from the political core. In the two-story state, the political core is what we call democracy, and in theory, it is stronger than the civic core. The civic core is the permanent civil service, as well as all legitimate institutions designed to serve or guide the state or public. This includes the press, academia, philanthropic organizations, and so on. Essentially, this is the cathedral. The civic core is not directly exposed to the political core. The Constitution itself prevents this, perhaps smartly, as giving the political core sovereignty is a dangerous experiment at best. Due to the constitutional law we examined earlier, the employees of the executive branch will be limited to the Overton bubble of the two stories. This keeps the power inversion of the civic and political cores nice and stable, ensuring that the civic core remains safe from public opinion. In true managerial style, not only is the civic core safe from public opinion, it guides it. This is what has been previously called guided popular sovereignty, and the apparatuses that guide public opinion are even more immune to democracy than the executive branch is. You can't vote professors out of office, nor journalists. The stagecraft, of course, is that the political core rules. In theory, you can, as they say, just vote the bums out. But for this to actually work, you'd have to vote in the right people to many offices, basically all at the same time, in order to have a shot at exposing the civic core to the political core. A dangerous and not recommended maneuver, by the way. Otherwise, the pressure release valves in the civic core will trip, and vent all of that political energy you unleashed into its hermetically sealed politics containment bureaucracy. Such a massive democratic undertaking sounds a lot like regime change in a single successful operation, and such a maneuver is probably best attempted outside of the formal political mechanisms. For one, since we live in a press-controlled state, you'd basically have to produce enough good press to overwhelm the bad press against such an operation. But let's just say you did manage to pull off this Herculean-coordinated democratic feat. You'd still have the entrenched and firmly non-democratic civic core for these newly minted officials to deal with, somehow. It might submit to your clear democratic will and give you a nice clean reset. Or it might not. I'm guessing not. So, tying this all together, we may have a situation in which a president is entering office with expectations that are not only wrong, but directly contrary to how USG works. Of course, we shouldn't assume that Trump or his team were totally naive, but there is good reason to believe that their plan was not congruent with how USG actually functions. Almost no one knows how it functions, not even the people in it. This perspective also explains the highly energized progressive response to President Trump. Most people have this wrong conception regarding the flow of power between the political core and civic cores of government. The Trump campaign, and not even the Trump presidency, is responsible for at least 50% of the left's reaction to the Trump presidency. It primed them to fear a dictatorial presidency that would regress America back to the antebellum era, or whatever. They think the president actually has dictatorial power because their president, Obama, used executive power more like a dictator. But this type of presidential action is only possible when the executive and other branches of government are sufficiently aligned with the cathedral. Of course, a left-wing president can exercise power freely, and a counter-revolutionary president cannot. To reactionaries, the reaction to Trump looks absolutely insane, because it is so obvious that he is not even 10% of the threat to the cathedral that we wish he was. So, the civic core, political core model explains what's going on in both sides of politics. It also tells us that if we can elect people who actually understand the power structure of USG, the real power structure, then that's a start. But of course, the neo-reactionary understanding also basically tells us that elected officials are the last place you should be looking to affect that structure. While it's possible to think about a super Trump or many super Trumps in Congress, it should be obvious that this is not realistic. There is only one Trump, and even as president, he has very limited power, and individual congressmen have very limited power as well. The cathedral is built for neutralizing democratic threats like this, and it's not simply going to allow this sort of thing to happen in plain sight. Trump has accomplished many things that seem good on their face. We have legitimate progress on the wall. Some tax cuts, no Trans-Pacific Partnership, no Paris Accords, and we haven't started any new wars. But all of these setbacks will be temporary against a determined foe, unless the root of the problem is addressed. And the foe is determined. The cathedral is a mechanism, but it is not simply a place that you can walk into and take over. The cathedral is immense and composed of complex, organic processes, but it is not quite conscious. It does not auto-generate the entirety of progressive ideology. The cathedral is owned by its high priests, and it may be set on autopilot, but there is a conscious entity there to correct it when it deviates. It is at least reasonable to assume that if neo-reactionaries can reverse engineer the cathedral from outside, then on the opposite side, the inside, there must be people who are equally or even more aware of it, and that rather than oppose it, they play into it. And of course, we do not really have to assume this, as it has become quite clear for a long time that there is an actual internationalist agenda that is consciously and systematically being implemented by a specific group of high priests. If the cathedral were just a mechanism, then perhaps Fabian incrementalism could work, and it would be possible to simply repurpose the machine. But the machine is guarded, and whether or not its current watchers consciously created the cathedral or merely inhabit it is mostly inconsequential. What matters are the current possibilities given this system. Neo-reaction identifies two modes of individual action that can alter the regime one lives under: voice and exit. Most regimes formally codify both of these. In the United States, voice is our religion, and you can exit freely if you want, although few choose to. The US is a high-voice, high-exit regime. Exit is done simply by hopping on a plane or boat and leaving. Voice is exercised through democracy, one of the sacraments of the cathedral's atheocracy, and it also happens to be the very means by which the high priests of the cathedral trap civic energy. Performing the sacrament of voting is essential to maintaining the cathedral's legitimacy, and therefore, participating in this ritual is more often than not detrimental to any objective that involves fixing the system in any meaningful way. Speaking of this, there is a third mode by which the regime one lives under may be altered. It's often called revolution or regime change, but we will use the more neutral reset. A proper reset is easily identified, and it occurs when there is a clear break in continuity between one regime and the next. A clear example of a reset is when the Articles of Confederation were replaced with the Constitution. Examining voice and exit again. On voice, I will just say that half of neo-reactionary canon is basically dedicated to explaining how voice is cheated and always, in the end, favors the cathedral. So if you need that explained, watch my Mulling Over Moldbug series or read his blogs yourself. Specifically, you might want to watch my video on guided popular sovereignty, if you are not familiar with the term. Bio-Leninism also relates here as a degenerative process that afflicts high-voice systems. I will say, however, that I think Moldbug actually underplays the importance of guided popular sovereignty in his open letter. Popular sovereignty isn't merely guided away from the ideologies deemed bad by the cathedral, and it isn't even guided towards progressivism in the general sense, but rather towards whatever progressive policies serve the internationalist elites, the high priests of the cathedral. Voice doesn't work not merely because of some evolved mechanism we call the cathedral prevents it mechanically. It doesn't work because conscious entities in positions of great power aligned with the cathedral are hell-bent on not allowing it to undermine their plans. The early history of neo-reactionary thought from Moldbug consists mostly of a debugging of the system, explaining what it is and how it got that way in a mechanistic fashion. However, in the last year especially, it has become clear that while the non-conspiratorial, non-moralistic model of the cathedral is an excellent way to understand the regime, it must be synthesized with the possibilities of specific intentions from powerful individuals and groups working within it. This specific project is better set aside for another video. With the return of Moldbug, neo-reaction is entering a second phase of thought, and with this it is capable of self-critiquing, which is something I intend to do in subsequent videos. For now, we've done enough on voice, and on exit, there is not much to say in this context. Exit can help build healthier societies, but by its very nature does not solve problems in the homeland of a nation. That leaves us with reset. Reset is the primary means by which the cathedral is erased, and figuring out how to do reset has more or less been the fundamental problem that Neo-Reaction is trying to address. Reset happens to be the concern of the internationalists as well. I alluded earlier to the specific intentions of powerful individuals and groups. We won't get too much into these here, and I suggest watching Dave Cullen's recent and excellent videos on this. The Great Reset of the Internationalists is in full swing, and this revolution is more than just riots, Chaz, and the BLM/LGBT agenda. 98% of it is invisible, happening in the boardrooms and HR departments of corporations. Some of it is simply not mentioned in the news, such as the inflation of the monetary supply, the purchasing of stock by the Federal Reserve, and the general destruction of businesses due to forced closures. The more insidious parts of it are becoming more openly expressed, such as the elimination of property and dietary staples. The president has managed to slow some of this down, but the people behind this decades-long project are not simply going to throw in the towel after a few international agreements have been cancelled. Where are we, and where are we going? At the rate the right is apparently going, there is no way we will outpace the Great Reset. We need a reset of our own. What is needed from the president is less monitoring the situation, and more of a blitz against the cathedral, before it has a chance to adapt to Trump. To be fair to the president, he has canceled the TPP and withdrawn from the Paris Accords, to name just two important steps, but what he hasn't done and hasn't even come close to doing is defeat the cathedral. There is still potential in him, but it must be realized as a kinetic attack. Executive Order 13957 is obviously related to his order banning critical race theory from the federal government, but unless the threat is actually executed, then nothing will happen. We're approaching the critical point where he can either smash the machine or end up as another speed bump in its history. For me, voting is an extremely low opportunity cost action, and because I think that the detriment of supporting the regime versus the chance that Trump might actually trigger a reset is a chance worth taking, I will vote for Trump again. But this time, not because I can think that I can change the country in the way that I want with a voice, but because I might get a reset. So, although it may seem that I have spent a lot of time in this video explaining why this is probably not a good idea, and indeed it may well not be, the point to take away from this video is that you ought to be thinking about sovereignty in ways outside of what you are used to, and in particular, question fundamental assumptions you may have about voice. This video was much more exploratory for me than my typical explanation-style videos on Neo-Reaction. I realize that I covered quite a lot of ground rather swiftly here, but hopefully this video helps you in thinking in new ways, just as the making of this video helped me. Thanks for watching.